So the first thing I'm gonna do with this block of dough is I'm going to release the tension. So it's been stretched out this way, which means that it's holding tension. I'm gonna stretch it basically the other way to release that tension. And it seems like a small thing, but it's actually a really big deal. If you don't do this step, then when you go to cut your croissants out, they're going to contract in size, and you'll end up with croissants that are sort of narrowing on you. And the telltale sign of that is if you get a final croissant that has a smaller top from its base, so it's like starts to look a little bit triangular. Now I'm just gonna basically, these are 3 inches by 5 inches, so I am scoring them to get a guide of where I'm gonna be at. So we've got a little bit of extra scrap here at the top, and there's some things we can do with this scrap. So we doing rosemary with these, or?
I'll probably make these into chocolate.
Okay, cool. So we try not to waste the ends. These days we're trying to get standards from each block, and it's easier said than done, but just trying to get the maximum amount of yield out of everything and get a handle on, so that we can do a better job costing everything. But as you can see, as I'm cutting these, they're not contracting. And that's a good sign. At this stage, if there's too much tension in the dough, they'll just start to contract. And then we have our chocolate bars. These chocolate bars are locally sourced from a local chocolate maker. This is as opposed to a chocolatier. Whenever you're dealing with people in chocolate, there's basically two kinds of chocolate people. You'll find the people that make final chocolate, meaning they're often like taking a variety of different chocolate products and putting them together to make like final treats. And then you'll find people rarer, but you'll find people that are actually making chocolate from scratch, from cocoa beans. And this chocolate is from that latter group. So we have these custom bars that are made for us. And two of these bars go into each one of these. We roll them up. And this is the final croissant. It's layered, so you can see that it's got a ton of layers in there. It's probably a little hard to see on camera, but that's the laminated dough of, depending on how you count, 81, 116, I don't know. We've had the debate back and forth of how many layers are actually in a croissant. You can see Dylan's just trouncing me in terms of the amount that he can do at once. And that's really been the name of the game over time. It's just like finding ways to get more done in less time, especially as the demand grows. You wouldn't believe how much pastry we're producing now. Once these are rolled, these could go directly into their final proof, and at that point you could bake them in about 6 hours or so. In our case, we will put them in the fridge for a little while, and we will take out only what we need to bake for tomorrow, so we can work a little bit ahead. You can slow down the process for up to a couple days this way. So these batches that we're making today are good for the next couple days to basically take out and do the final proof when necessary. I thought we would never have to do this again, actually, in this space when we built walk-in coolers. Before we had walk-in coolers, we learned that we could store these pastries really close together and then just simply retray them to bake. And so normally only 12 to 15 fit per sheet tray, but I'm gonna get 49. For storage in the fridge. And then before they go in their final proof, we're gonna have to take all of these and retray them in such a way that they can bake, because obviously if we bake these this way, they would all just fuse together. And you gotta be a little bit careful, because if the dough gets warm, they will start to grow and start to fuse together. So this only works if you have reliably cold storage for them, where you can put them this close together and get the storage component. It's unfortunate, because then we have to take the extra time to get them set up so that they can be ready to bake, which just amounts to extra labor. But when you don't have adequate fridge space, that is the one of the mitigation strategies. So go figure that having five doors worth of reach-ins and having two giant walk-ins is just not enough. The crazy thing is just the amount of pastry, and there is no storefront. Like, this is all like people ordering and markets. We're doing the home deliveries now that we started doing back in June. So that's a way for us to continue to kind of grow our early in the week production. And then later in the week, it becomes market focused. There's some of the end pieces that were cut from the thinner dough. See how those turn out. Dylan and I like to work opposite. He puts the first bar of chocolate on the top. I put the first bar of chocolate on the bottom. I think his way's backwards. He thinks my way's backwards. You got that like whole double rolling thing going on, so.
Thank you.
Sort of crazy to think that like when we first started this process, really there was no different than a home baker's process. So if you think like the amount of chocolate croissants that we've made in the last 20 minutes seems like a lot, just know like there was a time where making 30 in an hour would have been ambitious in the beginning stages. So, you know, it's just when you do something every day, or in this case, like I'm doing computer work every day, you can see how like you can just keep developing your speed and your skill. So now we're gonna switch gears to a different type of pastry. It's gonna be the same exact roll form, except now we're gonna use white chocolate instead of dark chocolate. This is our second week making this product. And for me, I'm trying to hit those sweet tooths. The reason we brought this in was our chocolate croissant, it's made out of a 70% dark chocolate, and it's got like a fruity aspect to it, but it's also not very sweet. A lot of our customers really love it, but then there's a lot of customers that are expecting something a little bit sweeter, and I wanted to bring that to them. So you'll see us basically turning these into white chocolate. But the thing is, they have to be slightly longer, because not only are we putting two bars of white chocolate in them, but we're also loading them up with raspberry. So they need to be a little bit longer to take the extra stuff that we're putting in. Otherwise, we'd have to stretch the dough more and again sort of have a misshapen final. It's weird because it's one of the products that like I had an idea and I'm not the one executing that idea. So it's really had to, like, as we've grown, we've had to learn how to work as a team and realize that not everybody can be everywhere. So my role has been more valuable outside of the bakery, and I have to live with that for now, at least. When we get into our new space, hopefully that will balance out a little bit more when I'm not dealing with architects and engineers on a daily basis anymore. I know this is typically like a Valentine's Day flavor, but for us, since we have this relationship with a craft chocolate brand, it's more about just bringing to life what's readily accessible to us that people are gonna love. So for us, this is still a work in progress. We're really happy with the taste. And happy with the overall quality of the pastry, but we still think that there's room to grow in terms of execution on us and on the final product. So you'll probably see these evolve over time.